Welcome, welcome, welcome. I want to welcome you to yet another episode of the Unpopular Podcast. It's your boy, Jalen. And last week, a lot happened in the sports world. You know, from the NFL, NBA, a lot of college news, MLB. You know, a lot happened, and we'll talk about it. The first thing I'll talk about, I guess because I have a little further, a little deeper in the week, was Ron Rivera got fired. When we think of the Carolina Panthers, the two faces that we see is Cam Newton and Ron Rivera. Cam Newton is, of course, undoubtedly the best player the franchise has ever had. And Ron Rivera is the longest tenured coach that, and the most successful coach that the Panthers have ever had. We've been hearing all year, especially since Cam Newton got hurt and Kyle Allen's been playing serviceable, we've heard all year that the Panthers are trying to move on from Cam. Cam Newton is not the greatest quarterback when it comes to accuracy, but he does have a lot of traits that make him as good as he is, to make him a very good quarterback. With Cam Newton going down, this is, I think, maybe the second year in a row he's dealt with an injury that's kept him out more than 50% of the season. And with the thing that Kyle Allen has that Cam Newton doesn't is Kyle Allen is a little bit better when it comes to accuracy. While he doesn't have the running ability as Cam Newton, he doesn't have the he's not as physically dominant as Cam Newton. He's more accurate in how the league is going. Of course, you need accuracy. Of course, you need mobility. You look at Lamar Jackson. You look at Patrick Mahomes. On a lesser scale, you look at Dak Prescott. But when we talk about the league, what Patrick Mahomes, Lamar, Dak, some of the Drew Brees, what they have is accuracy. And while I don't think Kyle Allen is a starting quarterback, he has been serviceable. Which is why you've heard since Cam Newton went down that they're looking to move forward. The organization is looking to move in a different direction. And with them looking to move in a different direction, to me, it's kind of hard trying to move off the quarterback and not off the coach as well. And seeing as though last week, because they lost, again, they have been knocked out or they've been eliminated from playoff contention, I think that gave the Panthers organization the out to fire Ron Rivera. Ron Rivera is still a very good coach. I think by the time the season starts next year, he will be on a team. He'll probably be a head coach. I mean, there's a lot of places that's going to be looking for a head coach. You might have the Jets, the Cleveland Browns, I'm not going to say the Chargers, the Giants maybe. You have there's going to be teams that are looking for coaches. So I can say Ron Rivera will have a job. Whether it's, to me, it's going to be a head coach, but even if it's not a head coach, Ron Rivera is still good enough to have a job somewhere. And with Ron Rivera being fired, to me, this is, the 1-2 punch when it comes to what the Panthers are trying to do. The players were not happy that Ron Rivera got fired. You saw that on the game on Sunday when a lot of players came out and said they were unhappy and they played like it. I think they lost by 40. And when I say 1-2 punch, firing Ron Rivera almost ensures that they will get rid of. No, I'm not going to say get rid of. They will move on from Cam Newton. They've already talked about they're looking for trades. They're definitely listening to trades, but it's going to be hard. It's very hard as a new coach to integrate with a quarterback like Cam Newton. And when I say that, a long tenured quarterback that is already kind of stuck in his ways. It's kind of hard, especially when you're trying to rebrand, grow the organization. Once you get rid of the coach, more than likely, unless it's like Drew Brees or something, he's had one coach, more than likely the quarterback's gone too. You have Kyle Allen, who the Panthers think can be a building piece. You have CMC. You have the defense. You know, that defense is still, when it's firing on cylinders, one of the top defenses in the league. Carolina Panthers, not to mention, they will have a solid draft pick come this draft, which is a kind of loaded draft, especially for offensive players. I can see why you'd fire Ron Rivera. I don't think there's coaches that deserve to be fired and get fired, and then there's coaches that don't deserve to get fired but get fired for reasons that are understandable. Ron Rivera left with class. He left kind of with his head up high, because he knows he's not a bad coach. He just knows the organization is going in a different direction. It'll be kind of hard for Ron Rivera to now teach a whole new quarterback, a whole new offense. You know, he didn't want to do that. So he understands. So they had a press conference. There was cool. Bada bing, bada boom. We out. Again, I think that maybe the Browns, the Cowboys might be looking for a coach. Who else? The Jets, the Giants. One of those teams to me will be in the hunt and will be in a discussion for Ron Rivera. Now let's move over to Cam Newton. With Cam Newton leaving, I think Cam Newton will be gone this offseason. Where is a good place where I think he can go? Cam Newton is a very physical, big quarterback. Now, to me, that physicality has got him to where he is today. Now he's dealing with a lot of injury because he takes a lot of punishment. But he does have the body type to take punishment. To me, the perfect place for Cam Newton, I'm not going to call it perfect because there is a downside to it, but a good place to me that Cam Newton can go are the Bears. To me, they have a solid offensive line. They have solid weapons. You have Tyreek, you have Cohen, you have Robinson, you have some pieces. The defense is still a top defense when it's engaged. You have a really good coach that can scheme. The only downside is it's cold and it's windy, and Cam Newton already kind of struggles with accuracy, so that with the wind, that's that. But I can see him being a really good fit for the Bears. I can see him being a really good fit for the Chargers. Phillip Rivers you can kind of see when the writing's on the wall, and the writing is kind of smeared on the wall now. He's not accurate anymore. He throws a lot of interceptions. It's almost a wrap for Phillip Rivers. But he'll be a really good fit for the Chargers. He'll be a really good fit for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Jameis Winston right now has 23 interceptions. 23 interceptions. And there's still, 4 or 5 games left? To me, that's incredible. Yeah, they're trying to move off of Jameis Winston. I think Cam Newton will be a really good piece for that. So I think that Cam Newton will end up on a really good team that can suit his needs and can be in contention as soon as he gets there. And I think Ron Rivera will land on his feet, before everything's said and done. What else? Are we going to talk? Let's stay with football. So we talked about the Cleveland Browns being a good fit for Ron Rivera. Someone that is not good fit for is Odell Beckham Jr. So reports came out this week saying that Odell Beckham Jr. not only is trying to get or is playing with a sports hernia, but he's been telling, and this is reports, I don't know, he's been telling players and coaches on other teams, come get me this offseason. So when the season started, I thought that the Cleveland Browns can go one of two ways. They can be really good or really bad. To me, there was no in between. you have a young up-and-coming quarterback with, very, to me, one of the most on paper, they have the most explosive offense in the league. Kareem Hunt, Odell Beckham Jr., Jarvis Landry. You have, what's his name? I forgot his name. But you have some explosive pieces. And you have a really good defense with Myles Garrett. Or you could be really bad. Baker Mayfield last year, while he had a really good stretch towards the end, you also had to see who he played. He didn't really play anybody that was good. Odell Beckham Jr. is a wide receiver that needs a lot of touches. And if he doesn't get a lot of touches, he can be moody. While he's not as moody as Odell Beckham Jr., Jarvis Landry is the same way. And we already know about the what comes with Kareem Hunt sometimes. And that's a lot of personalities to maintain as a first-year coach. Not just a first-year coach in the NFL, first-year coach in Freddie Kitchens. To me, that alone was one of the worst decisions that the franchise has made in a while, but we're not going to talk about that. And as we've seen throughout the course of the season, everything that could go wrong, every distraction, has reared its ugly head. From the Myles Garrett incident, from all these shoe incidents with Odell Beckham Jr. and Jarvis Landry, with Baker Mayfield being in 100,000 commercials, yet he has more commercials than touchdown passes. He has more commercials than wins, career wins, not just this year, career wins. You have Baker Mayfield just saying anything to the media, talking about, you know, blaming Odell Beckham's sports hernia on the medical staff, going at the refs, going at sports media people. Odell Beckham Jr. averaging like two catches a game. Odell Beckham Jr. has only been in the end zone twice this year. How do I know? He's on my fantasy. I don't want to talk about it. Jesus. To me, while I don't think Odell Beckham Jr. is the problem, I think that the Cleveland Browns and Odell Beckham need a healthy divorce. Because it's not working. Odell Beckham Jr. needs a quarterback that's not only accurate, but is willing to give him the ball and trust him enough to throw him the ball multiple times and can get him the ball multiple times. Baker Mayfield is reluctant to pass Odell Beckham Jr. the ball. When he does pass the ball, he be airmailing it. Like, it goes over his head. He throws it behind him. He gets it picked. A good team, and Odell Beckham Jr. to me needs a player that's an alpha dog, not only off the field, but on the field. To me, Baker Mayfield is an alpha dog off the field because he says he talks like an alpha dog. He talks like he wants to be the man. He talks like he's the man. But his play does not warrant what he says. His play does not warrant as much as he talks. And Odell Beckham sees that like a player that talks a lot that can back it up. And as a quarterback is no one. All the great quarterbacks, you barely hear talk unless they're asked a question. Look at Lamar Jackson, the most explosive player in the league right now. Barely says anything until the media talks to him. Patrick Mahomes, Aaron Rodgers, Drew Brees, Dak Prescott, Deshaun Watson. You don't hear much of anything from them until they're asked a question. Baker Mayfield talks like Jerry Jones. You just be talking. I think the Cleveland Browns have a lot to get fixed. I've said this multiple times, and I will say it again. Just you put new paint on a house doesn't mean the foundation is strong. The Cleveland Browns foundation is still a foundation of losing. It's going to take a while to get to build that foundation up. And you're not going to build that foundation up talking a lot, having a bad coach, a coach that's just clearly in over his head. You have to get the foundation straight first before anything. And right now, it's clear that the foundation of the Cleveland Browns is still losing, which is why they can have one of, if not the most talented roster in the league, and still losing. And probably won't even make the playoffs. You hate to see it, but that's how it is, man. That's how it is. The Cleveland Browns won't win anything. It's not just a Baker Mayfield problem. It's not just a Freddie Kitchens problem. It's a Cleveland Brown organization problem. I would say it starts from the higher up, but it starts everywhere. Like, there's not one place that you can start. You know, it might start to get rid of Odell Beckham. I'm not saying Odell Beckham's the problem, but if you want to start somewhere, get rid of Odell. Then get rid of Freddie Kitchens. I'm not saying, like, they're equal. Freddie Kitchens has to go. I don't think he'll get hired again. But that's all. I don't. It's bad, man. Sticking with football, let's move over to the college football. So college football, we saw the college football playoffs are set. You have number one LSU after beating Georgia in the SEC championship. You have number two Ohio State after they won a nail biter. Well, it really wasn't a nail biter after the second half, but they beat Wisconsin in the big whatever they're in championship. You saw Clemson, they just smacked Virginia. I think they put like 63 on Virginia Head. And you have Oklahoma, who won against Baylor. To me, it's three teams and then one. Like, there is, to me, when you look at Ohio State, when you look at LSU, when you look at Clemson, and you think about, you talk about completeness. To me, the two most complete teams out of those three is Ohio State and Clemson. Ohio State hasn't really, except for one half in the, was it Big 10, Big 12, Big 10? Big whatever, championship. They've been dominant this entire year. With Heisman candidate Chase Young, who we'll talk about in a minute, Heisman candidate Justin Fields, who we'll talk about in a minute, they have, and Justin Fields being a freshman, they've looked incredible. They have looked dominant on both sides of the ball. Now, they will say, but who have they played? They've played Wisconsin. They've played Michigan State. They've played Michigan. They've played teams and have won. Convincingly, too. Even against Wisconsin the other day in the championship, they were down. I think they were down like 21-7. And came back and erased that deficit like that. But then you look at Clemson. People have complained this whole year. Clemson hasn't played anybody. Clemson hasn't played anybody. Clemson hasn't played anybody. They only beat North Carolina by 1 point. They struggle with other teams. I understand, and this to me is why Trevor Lawrence is not in the MVP, not in the Heisman race, because they struggled coming out the gate. This was the first full season that Trevor Lawrence is a starting quarterback. They lost a lot of pieces to the NFL. They're integrating new pieces, so they had a very slow start. But towards the halfway point of the season on, Clemson looked like the old. In fact, Clemson looked better. One thing that Clemson, especially let's talk about the defense. One thing that Clemson has been dominant at is the defensive line. Their defensive line, I think most of their defensive line from the last 2 years in the NFL now. you know, Dexter Lawrence, you got Farrell. They're in the NFL. And Dexter Lawrence is making noise in the NFL. And Farrell, I think. If you look at this Clemson now, while their defensive line isn't as strong, their defensive, like the backfield is incredible. They might have the best defensive backfield They probably have the best defensive backfield in the college football playoffs. And then you still have Trevor Lawrence. You have Tien. Like, you have – that's a complete team. And nobody – to me, no – Ohio State and LSU were fighting. We're fighting not to get that number two spot. Because I didn't see – unless Clemson lost, I didn't see Clemson moving from that three spot. So – LSU and Clemson didn't want to win. LSU and Ohio State did not want to see Clemson in the playoffs. And now one, if not both, we'll have to see them. Because I think, I'm just saying it now. So right now it is 1-2, 1 LSU, 2 Ohio State, 3 Clemson, and 4 Oklahoma. We'll talk about Oklahoma in a second. I have LSU and Clemson in the national championship, and I have Clemson winning it all again. I remember I said before the season, it's no competition. It's going to be Alabama and Clemson's going to win again. I still hold that Clemson will win. To me, the only reason why I'm picking Clemson over Ohio State is because of Trevor Lawrence against Justin Fields. Trevor Lawrence has been here. He's played in the college football playoffs. He's played in the national championship, and he's won the national championship, won convincingly in the national championship. While Justin Fields has rose to the occasion this whole year, I think that Trevor Lawrence is just a little better when it comes, and he's been here, and he knows the level of focus, the level of moxie, the level of focus that I said focus twice that takes in this moment. While I do think that Ohio State's defensive line is better than Clemson's defensive line, I still think Clemson's defensive backfield is better than Ohio State's defensive backfield. That's why I have Clemson winning against Ohio State. I mean, yeah, the thing about LSU is while LSU and Joe Burrow have been incredible, They've been better than advertised. I didn't think that they would be this good. I thought, you know, the SEC, you know, Auburn's going to be in there. Alabama, LSU, you know, it was always those three. Maybe Mississippi State, maybe Texas A&M. I thought that's how it was going to be. But no, they've been smacking people left and right. Joe Burrow, and we'll talk about this a little later, is a Heisman candidate, and well-deserved. Joe Burrow will be one of, if not the top draft pick in the NFL. The only problem with LSU is their defense. Their defense. Now, the reason why their defense looks so incredible against Georgia in the SEC championship is Georgia struggles to score. That's not with Oklahoma. Oklahoma does not struggle to score at all. Oklahoma and Jalen Hurts will get up and down the field on LSU. Here's the problem, though. Oklahoma is in the Big 12. The Big 12 does not play a lick of defense. You can't go up against Joe Burrow and not play defense. And that is why I think LSU will handedly beat Oklahoma. LSU does have some pass rushers that are really good. It's just their back end is kind of suspect. Oklahoma has nobody on the defensive end, and that will come back. You have to have somebody that can pressure Joe Burrow, and they don't have anyone, which is why I think they will lose that game and lose handedly. So this is why I have LSU and Clemson in the national championship, and I have Clemson beating LSU just because LSU's defense is their weakness. While LSU's defense isn't terrible, it's not on the same level as a Clemson. It's not on the same level as Ohio State. While their offense is on their level, the defense is not. So, it could be a coin toss. No, that Ohio State and Clemson game is a coin toss. LSU is going to mop the floor with Oklahoma. And then the national championship we can talk about. So, that's what I have there. And with the college football playoffs, we have the Heisman finalists that were announced. You have Joe Burrow, the quarterback of LSU. You have Justin Fields, the quarterback of Ohio State. You have Jalen Hurts, the quarterback of Oklahoma. And Chase Young, the defensive end of Ohio State. To me, let's talk about each player before I give my prediction of who's going to win. Justin Fields is the youngest player. He's a freshman. He is the quarterback of Ohio State. To me, when you talk about one of the biggest surprises of the college football season, to me, that is one of the biggest. Justin Fields is one of the biggest surprises. Well, I mean, it's Ohio State. Ohio State always gets solid players. I didn't think Justin Fields was going to rise and be as good as he's been this year. He's still a little undersized, but Justin Fields, he has 40 touchdowns and one interception this entire season. And 10, and that's 10 rushing touchdowns. And because of him, they're number one in third down offense. Like, it's... Justin Fields has been incredible. Justin Fields can, while I don't think he's going to win it, Justin Fields has had an incredible season. And like I said before, if Justin Fields plays to the level that he's been playing and just block out the noise and play up to the competition, Clemson will lose against Ohio State. And Justin Fields is not a weakness. In fact, if Justin Fields isn't on the field, if it was any other quarterback, then Ohio State probably wouldn't be in the college football playoffs. And that is a testament to Justin Fields. Let's go over to Jalen Hurts. Jalen Hurts, ex-Alabama quarterback. The reason why I don't think Jalen, there's a couple reasons why I don't think Jalen Hurts will win. One reason is because he lost. They lost. They have out of all the Heisman finalists, he's the only one with a loss on his belt. And it was a bad loss, too. And the thing is, if you look at the last two Heisman winners, you have Baker Mayfield and you have Kyler Murray. Both Oklahoma, both under Lincoln Riley. And I think a lot of voters will be like, maybe this is more a product of Lincoln Riley than it is of Jalen Hurts. Which I think Jalen Hurts has flourished under Lincoln Riley. Don't get me wrong. I don't think that it's more Jalen Hurts or less Lincoln Riley. I think that Lincoln Riley has unlocked Jalen Hurts. And I think that that's why a lot of people are calling for Lincoln Riley to be in the NFL because he's such a great coach. And I think Jalen Hurts, as good as he is, he's a great quarterback. I think a lot of voters will look at him and say, this is probably a product of Lincoln Riley. Let me talk about Chase Young of Ohio State. To me, Chase Young is the best player in college football. He's one of the most dominant defensive ends we've seen in a while. He gets. We even saw in the in the championship he just played, they were triple and quadruple doubling him. The only reason why I do not think Chase Young will win this trophy is because when you look at the history of the trophy, which is the Heisman Trophy, it is a quarterback trophy. Mostly quarterbacks win it. And I'm not taking away from Joe Burrow, because we'll talk about Joe Burrow in a second. But I do think that if you just take the positions out, Chase Young has been the most dominant player in college football. But because to me, I don't remember the last time a non-quarterback won it. And I think that it was a running back that won. I believe. I don't remember the last time a defensive player won it. I might look it up. I might. But if you just take positions away, I think Chase Young is the most dominant player in college football. While I don't think Chase Young will go number one in the draft because the team that will be picking number one will be looking for a quarterback, and they'll probably pick Joe Burrow, I do think that he is the most dominant player in college football. I do think that he's the most NFL-ready player in college football, and I do think that he is one of the only players in college football that, to me, will have an immediate impact and an immediate positive impact on the NFL team. And then we get to Joe Burrow. There's a couple reasons why I think Joe Burrow will win this. One, because he's a quarterback. And like I just said, this is a quarterback trophy. I also think Joe Burrow has been the best quarterback this entire season. Yes, you had Tua that played well, but he was dealing with injury. And, of course, he had a season-ending injury. Jalen Hurts, Justin Fields. He, to me, is a complete quarterback. He has the size. He has the arm strength. He has the accuracy. He has the footwork. He doesn't have the Cam Newton, the Lamar Jackson footwork, he has a body type like Patrick Mahomes. While he's not as talented as Patrick Mahomes, he has the body type of Patrick Mahomes. And he's a mobile quarterback. He's very elusive in the pocket, and he's not scared to stay in the pocket and throw bombs from the pocket. And we saw that against Florida. I'm not Florida. We saw that against Georgia. And another reason why I think he will win this trophy is because, one, LSU is 13-0. He set an SEC single season passing record, 4,715 yards and 48 touchdowns. And he's on pace to break Colt McCoy's record of season completion percentage at 77.9, which is 78. And I think, I might be wrong, but I think Colt McCoy was a finalist to the Heisman. He might have won it, I don't know, but I think he was a finalist that year. Joe Burrow not only looks the part of a Heisman, but he's playing the part of a Heisman. And he's a quarterback. And like I said, that is a quarterback trophy. I think that Jalen Hurts, Justin Fields, Chase Young, and Joe Burrow, I understand why those are the four finalists. Of course, you could have put somebody in like Trevor Lawrence, but like I said before, they kind of struggled throughout the year, and a lot of people are saying they haven't played anybody, but they've been smacking everybody they played. I think that their hardest game was like Texas A&M, and they weren't good this year. You could put CD Lamb. You could have put him in there, but it's a wide receiver. you know, how they feel about wide receivers winning Heismans. There's a lot of people you could put in there. But I'm not mad at who, you know, the finalist at all. I'm not mad at that. So, again, the finalist is Joe Burrow, Justin Fields, Chase Young, and Jalen Hurts. So, yeah, that's what you get. Is there anything else I want to talk about college football? I'm not going to really talk about the NFL as terms of the games and the playoffs yet. I'm going to hold off on that. We did see the Eagles struggle against the Giants, and I have no faith that the Eagles will make the playoffs. I think that's the Cowboys will make it. We saw the Rams beat Russell Wilson, and I think that kind of brought Russell Wilson down in the MVP race, which I don't even think is a race anymore. I kind of think Lamar Jackson has that locked up because he won pretty ugly, but he won in against Buffalo. Patrick Mahomes beat Tom Brady at Foxborough, becoming the youngest quarterback to beat Tom Brady at Foxborough. And just a tidbit, the Patriots have lost three times. All three times have come from a black quarterback: Patrick Mahomes, Deshaun Watson, and Lamar Jackson. That's what I'm saying. Black don't crack. and there's nothing really to discuss. Oh, I will say this. I am winning in my fantasy. I know nobody cares, and I know I've really been talking about it. I am winning in my fantasy. This is playoff week. I am in first place. And how my fantasy set up, we play the same person for 2 weeks, and then we play the championship for 2 weeks, I think. I don't know. But I know I'm leading right now. So, hey, shouts out to me. What else are we going to talk about? I guess quickly, what else? Anthony Joshua, he beat Andy Ruiz to retain all them belts. It was like five belts he retained. And I mean, there's not really much to talk about. We kind of knew, especially after the first fight, Anthony Joshua, to me, he kind of overlooked Andy Ruiz, and Andy Ruiz snuck him. Like, I'm not going to say snuck him, but he snuck one in. And it looked like Andy Ruiz, who was already big in the first match, it looked like he did absolutely nothing but eat until the second match, because he looked bigger in the second match. He looked slower in the second match. He looked weaker in the second match. And Anthony Joshua had his full undivided attention and beat the brakes off of Andy Ruiz. Andy Ruiz, there shouldn't have been. If it were a split decision, that would have been probably the worst call in boxing history. And Andy Ruiz even came out and said poor training and the diet led to his loss, which I think he's just a less superior fighter than Anthony Joshua. But like I said, Andy Ruiz was fat. Anthony Joshua was ready for him. He took like five belts back from him. It is what it is. Moving on, let's talk a little bit of MLB. As we know, free agency's here. Steven Strasburg signed one of the biggest contracts a pitcher has ever signed in MLB history. With the Nationals, 7 years, $245 million. Well warranted for helping bring the Nationals the first ever World Series Championship. I think it was already going to be hard to sign Anthony Rendon. And with giving Strasburg all that money, I think it's going to be even harder to sign Rendon. I think that we can sign him. I think that we have the money to sign him. It's just, will we sign him? And I don't know. I hope he stays. I mean, he's one of the best he's one of the best players in baseball, and we have him. So, you know, right now they're saying the Dodgers and the Rangers are probably leading in the race. But, you know, if we're willing to pay the money, he should try to stay. I mean, I would want Anthony Rendon. It's looking less and less likely that the Washington Nationals will keep him. But, hey, anything is possible. I want Anthony Rendon to stay. So, Garrett Cole, they're saying that right now the Yankees are in the driver's seat and they're looking to offer him upwards of $300 million, which is definitely would be the largest contract ever for a pitcher. I don't know if that's well warranted. I don't think any player is worth $300 million that's in baseball at that. See, baseball is, like I said, baseball is not like basketball. Baseball is not like football. Like, baseball is closer to football than basketball, because if you look at basketball, if you have a transcendent player like a LeBron, like a KD, like a Kawhi Leonard, like a Steph Curry, James Harden, Giannis, you can warrant paying those players $300 million because those players can produce you wins. When I say LeBron James can get you to the playoffs just off name alone. Steph Curry, James Harden, one of the greatest offensive scorers we have. KD, to me, one of the best players that's ever played this game. They can bring you instant wins. When you look at baseball and a little bit of football, you can't really say that. Unless you're like a quarterback, like a Drew Brees, a Patrick Mahomes, a Lamar Jackson, Deshaun Watson, they can swing momentum more than, say, a running back can, or say a wide receiver can, but it's still a team sport. They don't play defense. Same as baseball. A pitcher can't play back-to-back. So a pitcher, like, you pay Steven Strasburg, and I'm not saying it's not worth it. I'm just saying you pay Steven Strasburg $245 million, and he might play 40 games a season. And a baseball season is, what, 162? 182? Something like that. No, it's 162. And he's not even playing half of that. So I don't think Garrett Cole, I don't think any player in baseball is worth $300 million. But if you're going to give him $300 million, give him $300 million. So I'm not, you know, I ain't hating. I'm just saying. last thing I'm going to talk about, the Knicks fired David Fizdale. Congratulations, David Fizdale. He's getting paid not to coach the Knicks. The Knicks are horrible, and while I do think David Fizdale could have done better coaching in some areas, I do think it's hard coaching a trash team. When you have 150 power forwards, when you have Frank Ntilikina, who is not an offensive weapon like that, when you have so many one-dimensional players, it's hard to win. Yeah, you have a lot of young pieces. You have R.J. Barrett. You have Kevin Knox. You have Alonzo Trier. You have Dennis Smith Jr. You have a lot of young pieces. But Dennis Smith Jr. is a one-dimensional player. Kevin Knox, he hasn't really come to his own. R.J. Barrett, you know, he's still young, and he's shown promise. Frank Ntilikina is still young, but he's not really an offensive weapon like that. This team is horrible because you have so many players that are one-dimensional, or you have so many players that play in the same position. You have a Morris. You have Taj Gibson. No, he's not on there no more. You have Randall. You have two players. I don't know how many times I've seen Morris and Randall dribble the ball up the court. Why is Morris and Randall dribbling the ball up the court when you have point guards? Again, shouts out to David Fizdale, man. Like, he's not a bad coach. That's just a bad team. When you look at some of the decisions that's been made, you really have to look at, we all know that the problem with the Knicks is the owner. When you have an owner that has come out and say, like, he's if you say anything bad about the team, Jim Dolan, who is the owner, can ban you. He's banned people for saying bad things about him. He's banned former players. We know, we saw the incident with what's his name? Damn, I forgot the former player that he kicked out, and it looked like they were about to have like a whole fight. It's the Knicks. See, James Dolan is not going to sell the team. The Knicks are still one of the most profitable teams in the world. Scott Perry hasn't done a really good job. I think that's the GM. Like I said about Chicago, not Chicago, like I said about the Cleveland Browns, it's a foundation. When you have a foundation of losing and a foundation of just horribleness, you can paint the walls however we want, but the foundation is still going to be weak. That's what you're getting from the Knicks. And the only crazy thing is the Knicks are still popular. They're one of the most popular teams in the NBA, one of the most popular teams in the world. They just suck. So shouts out to David Fizdale. They will suck for a while. Yeah, they have some young pieces. Like I said, they have RJ Barrett. They have Kevin Knox. They have Frank Ntilikina. They have Dennis Smith Jr. They have pieces, Alonzo Trier, but will those pieces bloom? It's kind of hard to bloom when the soil is rotten. And that's where I will leave you guys. This has been an Unpopular Podcast. I appreciate you guys for listening. I know I'm dropping this on a Wednesday. Yesterday was a really busy day for me. So I really wasn't in the house, and I wasn't able to record. And Monday was busy as well. So, again, I appreciate you guys for listening. Appreciate you guys. Love you guys. Please share. Please share. Please share the podcast. If you enjoy it, tell a friend to tell a friend to tell a friend. and share it, man. And please subscribe. Please subscribe. Please subscribe. It would mean the world to me to know that you are willing to follow me on this journey. This is what, episode 74? That's crazy. But again, I love you guys. Thank you guys. And until next time, much love.
I don't wanna try, but acidic, a bunch of bad habits with bad magic. Can't disappear and reappear in the same sentence. I'm bad at it. The mad hatter, the perk pack of the mom thrash. The perk mixed with the surf, turn me into a contractor. A straight tweak, so hot I can't speak. Been 3 weeks, I still haven't met my peak. Like I could be someone other than myself. Like I could find a little heaven up in my hell. Yeah, I know it never ever end well. Yeah, I know I always fall victim to a wish spell. Like abracadabra, the flow so raw, forgot to grab magnums. Been raw dogging bitches ever since I went platinum. I feel like hell full of bad bitches. Wonder if it's room in heaven for savages. My life's a canvas, I'm painting in blood like a cannibal. Rip off his head and I salvage it. A little too graphic. At least you niggas know that I still got the passion of someone who don't got shit. Put the clothes on they back and it's been that way since way back since. Like I'm a killer or something. These niggas lip singing like Millie Vanilli or something. I'm like Lil Wayne, I got a milli or something. I guess I'm rich and broke. Pockets bountiful. My soul's empty. So deep. 10 feet. Times 10 feet. Fuck love, it's gonna take more to convince me that you with me and not against me. Oh.
Where I'm from, we loaded up, popped out and turned niggas into miss me.
Don't shit.